Well, hello, good morning, good afternoon for everyone. This is the first time that we will have a webinar with our Greek friends. I just want to thank the Hellenic Orthopedic Association and the sports medicine branch of it. We also have the support of the Argentinian Shoulder and Elbow Society and the Argentinian Orthopedic Association. And Ortho TV, that is represented here by Sergio Rowinski from Brazil. We were speaking about the links between the three countries, and there are many historical links, but there are also the same, I think, way to face life, the same passion, the same way to do things, and we feel very comfortable with our Greek friends. Today, we will speak about shoulder instability. We will try to show you different techniques that we have developed. But before beginning with our scientific information, I would like to give Dr. Manos Brilakis the opportunity to introduce himself and the Greek Association.
Hello, my name is Manos Brilakis, and I would like to thank my web friend, Daniel Moya, for this great idea. And of course, Ortho TV and Dr. Sergio Rowinski that make it happen. And of course, I would like to thank the Greek Orthopedic Association, the Argentinian Orthopedic and Traumatology Association, and the National Board of Shoulder and Elbow that give their auspices for our event. And I'm very happy to be here with my Greek colleagues in order to speak, to share our passion, as you said, about the shoulder surgery. And without a further delay, I would like to ask Daniel Moya to start this webinar presenting the classic open Bankart repair.
Thank you very much. I will try to show you our experience and the procedure that we perform frequently to manage anterior shoulder instability with open techniques. Some years ago, someone asked himself if open stabilization was for dinosaur surgeons only. But time has demonstrated that these kind of procedures still have a role in managing shoulder glenohumeral instability. There is a third option between arthroscopic surgery and those procedures in which we use reconstruction techniques like the coracoid process or adding some kind of bone grafts. What are the advantages of these open procedures? Well, they are anatomical techniques, and if they fail, they give us the chance to face a shoulder which anatomy has not changed dramatically. They have a very good effectiveness for capsular placation, and they are very effective to treat, to deal with the rotator interval. And it has been demonstrated by many studies that they have a very low recurrence rate, even in patients that are exposed to collision sports. Of course, we do not use just a soft tissue procedure when there is a bone defect, but when there is no bone defect, these are a very reliable techniques. And they allow to add those other procedures if necessary. What about the surgical technique? Well, this is a modification of the Bankart procedure that I learned with Dr. Rockwood. And of course, as usual in shoulder surgery, it's very important patient positioning. We need to take time to be sure of that the patient is in a safe and in a very good position for us to have a good approach. As most of you know, the glenohumeral joint is not perpendicular to the coronal plane. It is in an oblique position. So just adding a pad in between the shoulder blades of the patients give us the chance to face frontally the glenohumeral joint and have less problems when doing the surgery. Generally, we use an interdeltopectoral pectoral approach. It is a short approach because the soft tissues here are really easy to mobilize. And there is a good tip about the technique, that it is to perform the subcutaneous dissection in an oblique way. So we use a very straight line for the approach, but we have an oblique dissection on the same direction of the cephalic vein. And this will give us a very extensive approach to deal with the glenohumeral joint. This is what we mean. These images are in Orthofix platform. And you can see here, we find the cephalic vein, we protect it, we move it laterally, and then we face the deltopectoral fascia. We release the lateral border of the conjoint tendon that you can see here. And we always localize by palpation the musculocutaneous and the axillary nerve. Then we generally find a borsa that it is very common in front of the subscapularis, and we resect that borsa to be able to see the subscapularis tendon and its fibers. We localize the superior border of the subscapularis by just putting a scissor in the rotator interval, and we will perform a partial tenotomy of the subscapularis, that is an inverted T. We begin by cutting in an inverted L to develop a medial flap and a lateral flap. The tendon here is blended to the capsule, and we need to find the planes between both of them to separate both layers. And I advise to begin by the inferior angle and go ahead in a cephalic way and medially. So we put some stitches to the subscapularis. We release the profound aspect of the tendon. And as we get medially, it will be easier, and we can even put our finger to complete the separation, to palpate the ridge of the glenoid, and we need to have a circumferential release of the tendon. So when we pull it, we feel an elastic resistance. This will give us a complete release of the tendon and an access to the anterior capsule of the glenohumeral joint. Then we will perform a vertical incision, a vertical capsulotomy. We need to have two good flaps, a medial flap and a lateral flap of the capsule. Here we are performing it. And we need just a few instruments, a Fukuda retractor and the so-called Fortiner retractors to access to the joint. And as you see, we will have a very nice view of the inferior glenoid. Here in the center, we see a Vanguard lesion. And if there is a bone defect, we will also see it as in the right. We next will work on the neck of the scapula to get some bleeding that will help us to have a healing of the capsule to the glenoid. And we use to practice bone tunnels to pass the sutures. That was the traditional description of the technique by Dr. Rogut, which used to perform three channels and pass two sutures. You can see on the right how we passed the suture. It was a very solid fixation. But of course, now we can use anchors for doing this step. And finally, we fixed the labrum. We performed the labral repair. And the next step is to close the rotator interval. This is very important, especially in multidirectional instabilities. After that, we will pass several stitches through the medial flap, and these stitches will go, the sutures will fix the medial flap to the lateral flap. But we need to put the arm in 20 degrees of external abduction, external rotation, sorry, and 20 degrees of abduction, just not to over-tight the capsule. So you can see what we expect to put the, to send the medial flap laterally and in a cephalic direction, and the lateral flap medially and in a cephalic direction. We will close the inferior pouch. If you put a finger in the inferior pouch and you pull from the sutures, you will realize how strong is this construction. This is an actual view of what we expect to fix the capsule to the scapula, to create an overlap of both flaps of the glenohumeral capsule, and to repair the partial tenotomy of the subscapularis without any shortening. This is the coronal view, where we see the stitches that are fixing the capsule to the glenoid, the stitches that are closing the rotator interval, the stitches that are fixing the medial capsule to the lateral capsule, and the stitches that are fixing the lateral capsule to the medial flap. As you see, it's a lot of work, but it's a very strong construction. If we need, we can add to this procedure a coracoid transfer. It has been described that the combination of the Vanker procedure with the Glatarchet procedure is very reliable, very effective. Here you can see the stitches that we have fixed in the border of the glenoid, and here we can have included the coracoid transfer. This is the result according to the motion. These patients really do not lose range of motion. If you want, you can use with this same technique a bone graft. You can see here an iliac crest bone graft. This is the radiological view, and this is the clinical result. And we can also extend this technique if we have these kind of cases. Massive rupture of the rotator cuff, a rupture of the subscapularis, dislocation of the long head of the biceps in a patient who suffered a dislocation of the glenohumeral joint. We just add a small incision in the subacromial space. Here you can see the bicipital groove is number one, it is empty. Number two is the bicep dislocated. You can see on the right the Vanker lesion, and we just proceed to the tenotomy of the biceps, we fix it, we repair the rotator cuff, and we fix the Vanker lesion, and this is the result. Sometimes we face this kind of patients. This was a UFC sportman. He dislocated his shoulder when fighting, and fight for 20 minutes with his shoulder dislocated. So he got a rupture of the subscapularis in the myofascial juncture, and as you see on the right, a bipolar rupture of the capsule. It is interesting to see the anterior part of the shoulder has an explosion of inflammation, and the capsule was torn at the level of the humerus and at the level of the glenoid. Well, we performed the repair with the technique I mentioned. You can see before and after here the axial view, and here the sagittal view before and after. And this was the result. Fortunately, this patient recovered his strength and range of motion. Sometimes we have these cases, voluntary multidirectional or also positional multidirectional instability. We are very happy with the results. It is not easy to deal with these cases. I think that the chance to have a good placation of the rotator interval is very important in these cases, and the closure of the placation of the capsule. Generally, we perform an arthroscopic procedure if we have doubts about the posterior inferior labrum as a first step in the same surgery. And this is the result, and as you see, we can use very small incisions in these patients. Open Vanguard is a very reliable technique, and someone that is very important in the history of arthroscopic surgery of the shoulder, like Robert Arciero, has stressed that and has said, don't forget the Open Vanguard. And I think this is the message that we want to transmit today. It is an anatomical technique, very flexible, as you can see, because you can add other techniques to have a good result according to the type of lesions that we see, and it does not require an expensive set of instruments. So thank you very much for this opportunity again, and thank you to our Greek friends and Ortho TV for this possibility. So now we will be go ahead with Dr. Manos Brilakis. Is it that right, Manos?
Yes, of course.
Good.
Thank you for your talk. I was really very curious to listen it because really I have never performed an open Vanguard repair. I have seen 3 or 4 times many years ago to be performed, and I was very curious to see it. So my talk is about arthroscopic Vanguard repair, and if we can perform it, if we should perform it alone or with augmentation. This is my disclosures. And in anterior instability, the essential lesion is the Vanguard lesion. And the Vanguard repair is the operation we use to restore the labrum to its anatomic attachment and to reestablish the appropriate tension in the glenohumeral ligaments and the capsule. But the results of the arthroscopic Vanguard repair are not so good in the literature. And here is a study that shows the recurrence rates about 30%. And the 50% of them are happened within the two first year post operatively. And the average of 10 years failure rate for the arthroscopic Vanguard repair is in the literature between 20% and 40%. And this is the factors that we take into consideration when we have to confront anterior stability cases. And this is our patient-related factors, the age, the sport participation, and the laxity of the patients. But this is the most important factor for decision-making, the bone defects. And we know from the early 2000, from this classic article from Burkhardt, that the recurrence rate is respective to the bone defects. And the bone defects are almost in every case. Even in after the first time dislocation, 70% of the patients has bone defects. And here are some studies that shows that non-bony lesion was found in 14.4% of 153 patients prior to arthroscopic Vanguard repair. And here is another study that shows in these patients, almost everyone has at least a least bone defect present before the operation. So we try to augment the classic arthroscopic pancreas repair with some soft tissue procedures in order to lower our recurrence rate. And here is the three more popular procedures for this: the remplissage, the subscapularis augmentation, and the dynamic anterior stabilization. And first of all, the remplissage is this is a term was introduced back in 2008 from Eugene Wolf, and this is a French word meaning filling, and it is a capsulomyotenodesis of the posterior capsule and the infraspinatus within the heel sachs lesion. And the indication of remplissage, according to Pascal Boileau, is the isolated humeral bone defect. And in fact, he has the lower recurrence rate in the literature with 2%. However, from the beginning of the, from early years of remplissage, the combination of bone defects was discussed as indication for this technique. And from the early 2000s, that the concept of the engaging heel sachs lesion from Bucher to 2014 and until today, the concept of the glenoid track and the on track off track lesions. This is the conclusion that it is the combination of the lesions, and we should not examine each lesion separately. And the question is, which is the critical bone loss? From the glenoid side, we started to discuss about 25%, that is the critical size for performing a bony procedure. And we have a subcritical size, 30.5%. And the last few years, we have some studies that speak about 10%. And 7%, and I bet that the next few years this number will decrease more. And from the humeral size, there are several classification systems for heel sachs lesion, but controversy persists regarding which is optimal. And the technique of remplissage, it's a simple technique. We abrade with a saver the heel sachs lesion, and we do some perforation, some drills, in order to make growth factors available for enhancing the incorporation of the tendon to the bone. And we use some anchors. We start to use one anchor, but now we almost in every case we use two anchors, one medial, one lateral. The only tricky thing is that one that we should confront with the sutures and to pass them from the posterior capsule and the infraspinatus. And if you can do this, it's a simple technique. Here is the passing, and we repeat it with a second anchor. And after maneuvering or the status, then we close the posterior capsule. And here is the starting point, and here is the ending points. The ending point, we decrease the posterior capsule. Our experience has been published to KSTA, the midterm results in 2014 and the long-term results in 2019. And we studied 65 patients that were operated for recurrent arterial shoulder stability with Bankart and remplissage, made all of them arthroscopically. It was 56 men and 9 women with average age 30 years old. And we have published an average follow-up for 8 years. Now we have overcome the decade, and the results are pretty the same. It was the same. 80% of them were involved in sport activities, and everyone has a positive apprehension test preoperatively. Our recurrence rate was 5.6%, which is pretty good compared to the average of the literature, and the rest of the patients were satisfied with the result. 70% of them continued to participate in sport activities without restriction. And as far as the shoulder function is concerned, every functional score was improved in a statistical significant manner. And as far as the shoulder mobility was not affected, at least at a statistical significant way. In fact, there was a slight difference in the range of motion, but it was not statistically, neither clinically significant between the two for every patient. And if we do a literature review, we see for the REBL results that it is a procedure with low recurrence rate, with none to minimal motion loss, and to have a very low complication rate. And there are studies that compare the arthroscopic Bankar to the arthroscopic Bankar plus REBLISAS, and the recurrence rate is reduced dramatically with adding this procedure. And this is a study that is very optimistic, 10-year follow-ups with no recurrence and no apprehension. And this is a cadaveric study that shows that Bankar repair alone did not prevent the engagement in any shoulder with off-track Hill-Sachs lesion, but adding to these shoulders the REBLISAS, engagement was prevented in every shoulder. And the mean complication rate in the literature is 0.4%, and this is the advantages for the soft tissue procedure compared to the bony procedures that they have a bigger complication rate. However, this is not a really good comparison because the indications are not the same. The ASA technique, the augmentation with the subscapularis, the second one, and the role of subscapularis has been highlighted many years earlier from a Greek orthopedic surgeon, Panagiotis Simeonidis. And the arthroscopic augmentation with subscapularis tendon was published in 2013 by Professor Maiotti from Italy. And this is not an anatomic procedure. And the difference with REBLISAS is that with ASA, we push the head back, while with REBLISAS, we pull the head back. And Professor Maiotti has published the result for this operation that prevent the anterior and the anterior inferior translation, and he's better than doing simple band repair comparing this study. And the first results, the first with 2 years minimum follow-up was this, the recurrence rate 3.4%, and the mean external rotation deficit was minimum. And recently, the same author published the results of this procedure, Bankard plus REBLISAS, from six centers, and there was 1,600 patients, and the total recurrence was 3.9%. And the atraumatic one was 1.7%. The external rotation deficit was not statistically significant. And Professor Maiotti was invited in our course, Athens Shoulder course, and he present his method, and he passed a tape through the subscapularis tendon, and then introduced an anchor to the anterior rim of the glenoid in 2 or 3 hours. And the final result is this. However, this is our technique. Sorry. Okay, we use a soft anchor and we pass the tape from the body of the subscapularis. And then we tie the knot. And here is the final result. However, lately we use this knot, and this knot, which is very, very strong knot. And I invite you to try it. It's a low profile, simple, but very strong knot. And our indication is hyperlax patients with capsule insufficiency and with glenoid bone loss lower than 10%. We did not do it in contact sport, but the late publication from Professor Maiotti is referred to this population. And our functional results was, our cancer rate was 5%, and our functional scores was pretty good and statistically significant comparing to the preoperative ones. And this is a patient that has been operated with an emplissage in the right shoulder with subscapularis augmentation in his left shoulder. And the results are pretty much the same. The current trend is the dynamic anterior stabilization using the biceps through the subscapularis. And we wait for the long-term results in order to see which technique is better or acceptable at least. So the take-home message is that the recurrence rate of bunion repair alone in the long term raises concerns, and we use additive procedures in order to augment the bunion repair, and respecting the indication and individualizing the treatment is the best option for improving our surgical outcome. Don't forget to join the section of a shoulder of the European Society of Sports Traumatology, FESCA, and follow in Facebook and social media. Save the date for the forthcoming ESCA Congress and the specialty days. You are invited to participate in our shoulder discussions in Athens Shoulder Course that it has been postponed for this year, but hopefully we try to make it happen again next year in Athens. And until then, we do some discussions with charismatic shoulders from all over the world. And I want to thank once again Daniel Moya for the idea, Sergio Rowinski for make it happen, Ortho TV for hosting, and every Greek and Argentinian friend that attend this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Manos. Was very clear, very nice. I can tell you that the Dr. Ashok from Ortho TV has told us that there are more than 800 people in the audience in this moment. Yes. So very good, very good. Go ahead, Sergio.
No, just one thing, you know, can we do just a little bit of discussion before we go to the other points, because there are many important messages for the juniors. I just would like to highlight, as I've been receiving messages from Indian orthopedic surgeons recently, there are many young guys, not senior surgeons, only watching this. So I have a very important question to Dr. Manos, which is a game changer about this technique. And I think it's a very nice point. Dr. Manos, see, I have always, I have a lot of experience with the classical bank arthroscopically, of course, and I have always avoided the subscap to avoid loss of external rotation in a way that I pay a lot of attention intraoperatively not to address the subscap. And we were considering a mistake, just allow me, to all of the things that I have been learning, to, I would say, to put the subscap together. And now we are learning new concepts, of course. But the thing is, I think there are two important points to ask you, having said this. First of all, once you enhance, you englobe the subscap in your construction, what about the loss of external rotation? I think that this is a very important point. And second, considering the risk of loss of external rotation, in which position of external rotation do you put the arm when you tie the subscap? I think that this is very important. And having said that, this is very easy to do, whatever is the external rotation in beach chair, which is what I do. But this must be a little difficult when you are in lateral decubitus. And I had the sensation that you, Dr. Manos, you do lateral decubitus, as I was seeing. I never do it. But having said that, how do you manage the traction? It's difficult to put external rotation on lateral decubitus. And being lateral or being in beach chair, which is the number of external rotation? And what about the fear of losing external rotation in a definitive way forever once you put the subscap together with the banker construction, with the banker repair? I think that is a very interesting point for you to explain, sir.
Yes. I believe that external rotation deficit is a dynamic condition, that if someone needs the external rotation, trains his arm in order to achieve the external rotation he needs. With arthroscopic repairs, we have not seen permanent deficits in external rotation. And Dr. Maiotti, in his study, refers that there is a 50 degrees in external rotation one and 10 degrees in external rotation two position, but our impression is that this number is lowered, at least in our group of patients. And I think that if someone don't need some degrees of external rotation for his daily activities or for his sporting activities, maybe he cannot earn never these degrees. But if someone needs these degrees, he definitely will manage to have the external rotation that he or she needs. And this is my impression and my experience. And as far as the position of the arm, Dr. Andreakis would like to add something.
Just one thing, Dr. Manos, Dr. Yes. Giannakis is going to speak in a second, but what is the number, in spite of, I understand everything that you said, but which is the number of external rotation that you usually use, or you don't care about it at all? I really want to learn this point, sir. Understand.
I used to relax the traction, but... I don't do it in extra rotation. I do it in a neutral position, or at least at a little extra rotation.
Okay. Dr. Giannakis.
Yes. So me and Manos, we are from the same department, and so there is going to be some repetition. But the point with ASA is that you don't take all the subscapularis, you take the upper part of the subscapularis. And there is a connection in the interval, rotator interval, between the coracohumeral, the subscapularis, and the anterior superior glenohumeral ligament. So what we are trying to do is to reestablish this connection, and by the pull of the subscapularis to increase the tension in the interval in the anterior capsule, interorbitor interval. Now, this technique is a technique for hyperlax patients, that they have an external rotation of 140 or more than 90 in external rotation one. And so reducing the external rotation by 10 degrees is something that goes usually unnoticed. In my experience, I have only one patient. Now we have about 100 cases. We have only one patient that he is complaining for this loss of external rotation. I mean, this is a problem for him. And he is very active, and he is doing gymnastics, and so, and he feels some stretching and pain, and he's complaining. And it's now 2 years after the operation, and I'm thinking of releasing it a little. He's stable. Now, more than that, when we do the operation, what we do is that we have we have some traction. We put only a 2 kilogram traction. So the traction is not so great. Most of the traction is made by the assistant first. Second, when we do this tightening of the knots, we put it in 45 degrees of abduction and in full external rotation. Second. Third, after the end of the tightening, we take the arm out of traction and we put it in full external rotation and abduction, 90 abduction, 90 external rotation, and see if the arm goes there. And in the beginning of our experience, sometimes the anchor was pulling out.
Oh, wow.
So now we know where to put it and what tension. This is a feeling rather, so that after the tightening, we are checking that we have at least 90 degrees of abduction, 90 degrees of external rotation.
You mean intraoperatively? You mean intraoperatively?
Yes, yes, looking with the scope. And what we see is that the subscapularis with the capsule is pushing the head back. In reality, it centralizes the head. It's not pushing it back, but it centralizes it over the glenoid. The patient's out of traction. We take the arm in abduction and external rotation slowly, and we see that as we do it, the subscapularis goes and presses the head. And
it's like just for us to understand, it's like a dynamic intraoperative test.
Yes, yes. Okay. We can't do it dynamic because he can't contract the subscapularis, but it's a passive, was putting the arm in, passively putting it in full external rotation, full abduction, not full abduction, 90 of abduction, 90 of external rotation, and check that this is something that is feasible. And in this way, we try to avoid a major loss of external rotation.
Sergio, I think this was a very important point, because we also in open surgery are always very concerned about the reduction of external rotation. But in cases of hyperlaxity, of course, we prefer to reduce external rotation and not leave the patient with a 90 degree or sometimes 100 degree external rotation as before surgery. So I think that's a very important point. But we will need to go ahead according to our schedule. And sometimes it is not enough with soft tissue procedures, and we need to go with bone grafts to repair or reconstruct the glenoid defects. Diego Gomez is a shoulder surgeon from the Buenos Aires British Hospital Orthopedic Department, and he will show us the procedure of the open and his experience with the open lateral jet. Thank you, Diego, for joining us.
Thank you so much. Just please confirm we are seeing the presentation properly. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay. Well, hello, everybody. I would like to thank Dr. Moya and Dr. Sergio for the invitation, and both the Hellenic and Argentinian Association. It is a pleasure for me to be here sharing this morning in Argentina with you. Well, as you all know, in the last decades, the arthroscopic bunker repair became the most popular option in many countries to treat the recurrent anterior shoulder instability. Having only 4% of redislocation rate in patients with bone defects, according to Stephen Burkhardt. However, in some conditions, like collision athletes and significant bone loss, An increased failure of the repair is usually observed, being as high as 90% in rugby players. So we consider that arthroscopic banca repair alone is not the ideal surgery in these cases, in these scenarios, being a latterhead a more reliable alternative. There is a high quality bibliographic evidence that supports latterhead in terms of recurrence. And if we take a look at these reviews done by our friends from the Irish group of Hannah Mallet, they review more than 800 patients with 10 years of follow-up, and they conclude that failure is 10 times more often after arthroscopic banker, and the revision surgery is 4 times more often as well. But of course, like everything in life, it has a downside, and what is wrong about latterhead is the complications, which are multiple, and in some cases, they can be serious and difficult to correct. Today, we'll focus a little bit in complications, and to do that, we will see our series in the hospital, in the British hospital. We have done 80 procedures in the last 5 years, and so far, we have noticed an 11% rate of complications with 5% need of revision surgery. The hematomas rate range between 2 and 3%, including infections, and we register one infection that require a surgical washout and 3 bulky hematomas that result without surgery. Even though it is a nasty complication, we don't want to see that. It's usually easy to treat and it doesn't have a negative effect on the final result. As you can see in this patient who has the infection in the previous image, who in these pictures, he has 2 years of follow-up with a great range of motion and a very good clinical result. In order to improve the cosmetic appearance of the scar, as Daniel showed, we use a vertical straight brass trap incision, which requires a preoperative landmarking since the location of the strap varies in women. And this simple technical trick allows you to hidden the incision behind the strap, and this gives a cosmetic acceptance much better. And another nice tip to avoid hematomas is the use of tranexamic acid. As it has been shown by the Irish group, it provides you less bleeding, less hematoma formation in the post-op, less pain, and less consumption of opioids. The neurological complications are as rare as they are catastrophic. Thankfully, we didn't have any of those, but you need to know the environment where you're working. You need to know that the nerve usually compromised is the musculocutaneous. To protect it, we should avoid unnecessary medial dissection, and we should be aware as well of the relationship with the nerve, of the nerve with the conjoint tendon. In the other side, we must also avoid a cross placement of the screws with potential lesion of the suprascapular nerve. And finally, there is another group of complications related with the coracoid healing and placement, and those related with the screw removal, which can reach a 10% rate. In our practice, we have 3 asymptomatic fibrous non-unions. None of these patients require a new surgery due to the lack of symptoms, and they are currently doing sports activities without any problem. But we did have a major shoulder complication in one patient with an incorrect and too lateral coracoid fixation, as you can see. The patient had a fast revision surgery. This correction must be done quickly to avoid humeral head injuries due to impingement. And in the other hand, if it is carried out before bone healing in a patient with sufficient bone stock, the procedure is rather easy. It's not a big deal to correct this. Of course, it's not desirable. And here you can see the correction of the graft in the 3D CT scan on the right. And again, the patient had a great result despite the complication. It has been said that latterhead surgery increases the risk of glenohumeral osteoarthritis. And you have spoken today about joint stiffness, but is it true? Is it worse with latterhead, these two things? Well, in this series of 800 patients with more than 10 years of follow-up, they describe a 38% rate of this complication, osteoarthritis, mainly being asymptomatic and low-grade according to Samilton and Prieto classification, with only one patient, meaning 0.12% of conversion to arthroplasty. But it has been clearly proven that this risk grows if you do a mistake in the technique, like a very lateralized graft, or you do the surgery at the time when the patient is 40 years old or older. However, the same group of authors carried out a review with a similar follow-up, a number of patients treated with arthroscopic Bankart, and they didn't observe a lower incidence of this complication, but on the contrary, it was higher. So according to the medical literature, we can conclude that latter-shaped procedure has risk of osteoarthritis. However, it's not greater than the one we observe with another treatments, so it may not be specific of latter-shaped. And yes, we have suffered this a few years ago when we started with open latter-shaped. We observed some severe limitations in a couple of our patients, especially concerning external rotation. In this nice review from Exeter, they compare every type of surgery for anterior shoulder instability, and they found that the arthroscopic soft tissue group has the higher rate of stiffness, being 7 times more frequent than latter-shaped. And in the same line, this meta-analysis of more than 1,000 patients showed that restriction of external rotation with Bankart is the double of latter-shaped in amount of degrees. So again, we may agree that loss of external rotation, it is a complication for open latter-shaped. However, it's not specific for the procedure, and you can see it in any stability treatment. Then we wonder if there is any way to avoid this problem and achieve a full range of motion. Well, I think there is a way. So I will give you 3 key steps I learned in the past years. The first one is regarding capsular insertion. Daniel has shown us how to duplicate the capsule, and it's really interesting. But in latter-shaped, we need to think if it is really necessary, if we have to do it as it was described some years ago. And I think it's not mandatory. And in our usual practice, we have patients with multiple previous episodes or with previous failed surgery, where the quality of the capsule is poor, it's not good enough, has holes, it's really thin. And in our hands, the reconstruction is not reliable. That's why we choose to resect the coracromial ligament, as you can see in the left. And we perform the surgery without doing a capsular insertion. In this cadaveric study done by Kleiner, they observed that the addition of the capsular repair, it is related with biomechanical restriction of external rotation, and this is not associated with an improvement of stability. So according to these results, the capsular repair may not be necessary in all the patients. However, if you want to do it, as it is described, you need to take into account a couple of considerations. You can repair it to the glenoid ring, resulting in an extra-articular bone graft, or you can repair it to the coracromial ligament as described by Balch. In this animation, it's easy to see the importance of doing it at maximal external rotation, or at least at the maximum you can do it. And remember, it's not the same as Daniel showed us 2020, because here with the extra size of the bone graft, you have more external rotation to do the duplicature of the capsule. And you need to know that every centimeter you shorten the capsule is equivalent to 20 degrees of external rotation. So if you do it to the anterior glenoid rim, this anterior capsular shortening, it is associated with a limited external rotation. That can be as high as 30% without the added benefits of stability. The second key step is the subscapularis. You also spoke about this. We know the subscapularis is the strongest rotator cuff muscle and is the most important active anterior stabilizer of the shoulder. So maintaining the integrity of the muscle is an important factor for the success of the procedure. And there are 2 approaches we can use: the horizontal split dissection at the junction of the middle and inferior thirds of the tendon, or the partial vertical tenotomy of the upper 2/3. This one is considered to be an easy and safe exposure technique. However, it may lead you to weakness in internal rotation and to a production of adhesions in the anterior part of the shoulder, limiting the external rotation. This has been studied by Ersen in 120 patients who observed a 50% endurance limitation in interrotation after tenotomy. And you need to remember most of these surgeries are done in athletes who play rugby or other sports, so they need interrotation. Palladini as well, in the largest study available in the literature with 376 patients, conclude that this approach is associated with insufficiency and stiffness. And he strongly recommend the muscle split approach for an optimal subscapularis function recovery. Finally, Markus Schäbel from Germany observed a 53% of insufficiency following a primary surgery and even a 91% following a revision surgery. For these reasons, we recommend to do a subscapularis split when performing an open lateral procedure. And as you can see, the view of the anterior glenoid is good enough to do a lateral check without any problems. Well, and this is linked also with the third key step, which is rehabilitation. As you know, if you do a tenotomy, the subscapularis, you need to protect it. You need to protect the repair for at least 3 or even 6 weeks after surgery. And recently there has been a move to begin the range of motion immediately to avoid stiffness. So I will show you a patient who is in the second day post-op, and he's doing passive motion and he's doing external rotation till 0 degrees to avoid stiffness of the subscapularis. We can do that because we protect the subscapularis integrity in the surgery. And this research from the group of Lyon underlies the negative effect of a delayed mobilization. They observed in a series of 265 patients that following a specific protocol of early rehabilitation, a full recovery of external rotation was possible at 3 months without any damage on the functional results. So to conclude, I think that the Lataschet surgery has resisted the test of time, obtaining reliable results in terms of recurrence, with a high number of complications, of course. Some of them, which can be really serious. So to reduce the incidence, an adequate patient selection, a meticulous surgery technique, and a correct management of rehabilitation is mandatory. Thank you so much. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Diego. If you agree, Sergio, we will go ahead with Manos Antonakis. It's difficult for us. And then we have a small discussion. Do you want that? Do you agree?
No, definitely, yes. I'm not going to speak now. Two messages for the young surgeons, because Diego explained it beautifully, for them to avoid mistakes that can be catastrophical in this surgery. But we discussed this after Dr. Manos Anto. It's difficult for me to speak. Giannakis. I'm learning.
Antonio Giannakis. Okay. Antonio. It's a matter of practice.
Yes.
For our foreign friends, usually we are Manos and Manos.
Manos and Manos.
And so I would like to thanks first of all, I'm Manos Antonio Giannakis, and I'm the director of the third orthopedic department in Igea Hospital in Athens. And I'm a fan and of shoulder surgery. So many people around me also are the same. And I would like to thank Daniel and Manos, because their idea of having this common meeting was great, and coming in contact passionate people with shoulder surgery from South America and Greece. I don't see Argentina because we have Brazil also. So now going on, just a moment to share a screen. Just a moment, we'll have problem. Okay.
This procedure, the arthroscopic antihernia net, is a procedure that gains popularity as times go by, and is an alternative of the open or the arthroscopic lateralization procedure.
Okay, now I think you can see me.
Yes, perfect.
Yes, okay. Perfect.
So, now, the next topic is going to be about arthroscopic edenhibinet, and this is a procedure that we do in our perform in our department, and I would like to share some thoughts about it. And so we are talking about the shoulder, and the shoulder is an inherently unstable joint. It has the greatest range of motion, sometimes much more greater than we can manage, and also it is a joint that is injured very often, and there's a compromise between stability and mobility in the shoulder joint. So the Bankart repair, the arthroscopic Bankart repair, gained acceptance as the standard of care during the 90s, and the results were very good. And there were many studies at that time and later that they showed comparable
going
results.
Going viral is tough. Everyone wants to go viral because they want
Excuse me? So, do you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so there were a lot of systematic, there was a lot of studies that showing comparable results with open and arthroscopic Bankart. But gradually we found that the essential lesion was not the only lesion. And as the years of follow-up increased, also increased the rate of recurrences. And this was a problem. And then at 2000 appeared this article that showed the significance of the bone defects from both sides, especially the glenoid. And this was a very interesting article at that time because, first of all, it was the operations were performed by very experienced soldiers, surgeons. Second, they included a lot of contact athletes. And what they showed is that if there were no bone lesions, even in these high-demanding patients, the recurrence rates could be very low. If there were bone lesions, the recurrence rate grew to unacceptable heights. And there were a lot of studies after that. And then came this this classification that tried to show us when to use a soft tissue procedure and when to go to a bony procedure. And then another study that was very interesting was this study by Pascal Boileau and Frank Baltz. It was in 2007 now. And what they did is that they went back and saw 130 patients that they had operated and they had repeated the same operation, a standard Bankart repair. And so what happened to them and what was the recurrence rate? They had a recurrence rate of 15% in 3 years. And they tried to find the factors that were responsible for this recurrence. And what was important in this study is that there was not only the anatomic lesions that were responsible for recurrences. There were other factors also that you had to consider. And this gave the ISIS score. And this score was the score that we use in many places and many times. And now we know that activity level, number of dislocation, shoulder laxity, bone defects, revision surgery are very important factors in our decision making. And we know also that we have to take them into consideration. And now we have also not only a qualitative measure, but also a quantitative measure. And now we know that if we want to deal with the shoulder, we have to take into consideration all of these factors. And if we want to deal with the anatomic factors, we have to take into consideration not only the Bankart repair, but the Bankart repair, the anterior capsule, the posterior capsule, and the bone defects, and try to act on all of them. And this is the way that we are going now. trying to have a stage procedure in the treatment of shoulder instability. And so we remembered again the Edenhibinet, a very old procedure that reappeared. And it was a procedure that was used with very good results as an open technique. It had a long follow-up, and also it could be used as implant-free, that lowered the cost of the operation. And also it could be performed arthroscopic. And we try using the modification of Edenhibinet that was described by Ettore Taverna. He was my mentor in this operation. And this modification used the iliac graft. We used the iliac crest graft. And this graft provided enough bone to do the reconstruction. We didn't have the problem of lack of bone. And we could reproduce the glenoid or even to increase the surface of the glenoid. And we could combine this operation with the ASA, the arthroscopic subscapular augmentation that talked Manos previously, or with Remplissaz. We did both. So we harvest the graft, and then we prepare the graft, and there are special instruments now that we can use and help to this. And then the important thing with this operation that is that we use guides from the posterior part of the joint, so avoiding the neuromuscular structure in the front of the joint, being very far from them. And there are now many modifications of this instrumentation from many companies. And we can use a special cannula in order to pass the graft into the joint. And we pass the graft through the interval. So we go through a way that we know very well. And we can use cannula or we can pass it without cannula. And if we see the technique is like this, first it's in lateral decubitus. This is the anterior part of the joint. So we prepare the area and then we rasp it. And then we introduce the guide from the posterior part of the joint. And then we pass two drills that are cannulated and we can pass the suture through these drills. And after doing that, we put the anchors. We usually use soft anchors now. And the interesting thing, we do it now because we don't want to hit the sutures of the graft that stabilize the graft. The graft is stabilized by buttons that are connected in the anterior and posterior part of the joint with sutures through the glenoid. And after that, we prepare the interval. We open the interval. And we use a cannula, the cannula, and pass the graft through the cannula into the joint. It's comparably easy procedure. And we are very familiar, all our surgeons, with these portals that we use in this type of surgery. And then at the end, this is the situation. And then we repair the capsule back to the original glenoid. And this is how it looks at the end of the operation. So why we use it? It's technically easier. There are very low rate of complications. It's a very safe procedure. We use a posterior guide. It is in very safe distance from all the neurovascular structures. We use the classical anterior portals through the interval. We avoid screws to stabilize the bone near the joint and near the humeral, near the glenoid and near the humeral head. We don't violate the subscapularis, especially if we don't perform an ASA. And the anterior anatomy of the shoulder is not disturbing also, and we don't have problems with scapular dyskinesis and all this problem with when we detach the coracoid. And if it happens to have a need for a revision, if the patient dislocates again the shoulder, it's very easy to do it. We have not done yet, but we think it's easy to do, as usually the bone would have reabsorbed, and we just have to remove the anterior buttons and then proceed with any other procedure that we want. And we published our results, and we were very satisfied. We were the first 28 patients. we use it even very low, small bone defects when we had patients that they were very active or very sporting or they were lax. And these are the radiographic images after the implantation. These are the buttons to anterior and to posterior to the joint. And till 2019, we had through to about 250 patients that we did the repair for shoulder instability, and 1/3 of them were bone block or bunkered repair and TASA. And thinking of what I was doing before 14, and we now do much more bone procedures, and we are much more our indications have been expanded. Then when to use Lataze? The Lataze has a very good result, very low recurrence rate after Lataze, and very satisfied patients. The problem is that there are a lot of complications also, and these complications sometimes are very difficult to manage. It's not only the rate of complication, but how difficult it is to manage these complications. And there is another article that appeared in 19 from Morodo, who compared the two procedures, the open Lataze with open J-graft procedure. This is not this type of procedure, but a similar one that used bone graft from the iliac crest also, and they had comparable results. So Lataze, why not use it in case of failure of this procedure instead of vice versa, as it's now done many times? We can restore even large bone defects with this procedure. We can easily combine it with other procedures that increase the stability of the soft tissues. It's technically easier and has much fewer possible complications. And seemingly the results are similar, at least in my practice. Thank you for your attention. And of course, we invite you to the 19th ESCA Congress. It's going to be a virtual congress next month. And to our course in Athens, it's a yearly course. Unfortunately, this year we could not do it. It's every February, every year. And now we do the mini batch series that we have discussions every the third Thursday of every month with surgeons all over the world. And we try to have interesting topics of shoulder surgery. Thank you for your attention again.
Thank you very much. Very interesting, your lecture, Manos. Sergio, we have 5 minutes for a short discussion, and we go ahead with the cases.
I have one very tricky question for Dr. Manos. I don't want to put you against the wall, sir, but this is a very high-level question, but very relevant. When we have, this is what I've been learning for many years, is that when you have to choose for a bony block procedure, an Edeni Binetti or a Lataze, we always choose here in Brazil, 99% of us at least, for a Lataze, because you have the sling effect, which you don't have in the Edeni Binetti. And having said that, when you have a failure of a Lataze, which is a nightmare, and I have had two in my life, we always have the Edeni Binetti as something upon the sleeve to do with these very difficult procedures. And there are many articles that say, save the Edeni Binetti for a failed Lataze, even because you have the failed Lataze, you have the sling effect in the Lataze and you don't have it in the Edeni Binetti. So we have a rationale to revise a Lataze with an Edeni Binetti, and I have done it twice. It was difficult, but the final results were very good. Radiographically, in CT, and most importantly, clinically. So I guess that you think on the opposite side, you prefer first the Edeni Binetti than the Latargie in spite of not having the sling effect. So I would like you to comment that. And when you have the failure of the Eden Ibinetti, how difficult would it be, sir, to do a Latargie? I think that would be extremely difficult, maybe more difficult than vice versa. This is a very tricky question, but it's real. So how do you manage this in these complex cases? Because unfortunately, Dr. Daniel knows these complex situations, they exist. So how to do the rationale? Because it seems you think absolutely on the opposite way as I have been with a lot of people here in Brazil. I would really like to listen to you, sir.
Okay. So what we have here is that when we do an Eden Ibinet, we restore the bone defect in the glenoid or even increase the bone in the glenoid, the platform of the glenoid. And in this way, we try to avoid to have an instability, a recurrence. And then we have the problem with the capsule. In my experience, most of the time, you can restore the capsule. At least in the patient that I face, you can restore the capsule and the labrum. Most of the time, it heals more medially as an ulcer lesion. And you can take the labrum and the capsule out of the wrongly healed position, the medially healed position, and restore it back to the glenoid. And in this way, you can reproduce the capsule. And then, of course, you can reinforce this with either a remplissage or an ASA procedure. And okay. In this way, we have an effect of the deficient capsule. We can reinforce the deficient capsule. Now, the question is why the Eden Ibinet is going to fail? Probably the bone is going to be reabsorbed most of the times. Mm-hmm. And then you have a situation where you don't have the bone there and you have only the screws if you use screws. Now, if you avoid the screws and use the buttons, the system that okay. we use, then mm-hmm. you don't have even the problem with use. So in my mind, I have never revised an Eden Ibinet, and in my praxis, we had only one failure of Eden Ibinet, of this type yeah. of Eden Ibinet, and the patient is not revised yet. And I am thinking of revising him with Latarge. Very active snowboard, the skiing and all this, and had an accident again, and he, and the bone is reabsorbed. It's the only patient that we have with full reabsorption of the bone. Most of okay. the time, the bone reabsorbs to the original glenoid. So, I don't think it's going to be a difficult revision. For me, it's a very easy revision. I'm going to be the same situation that I am in the beginning. Now, if I do a Latarge and I try to revise a Latarge, if we do in classical manner with screws, then I have broken screws and I have completely changed the anterior anatomy of the shoulder. Now, in every shoulder surgery that I do open, the first thing that I look for after the cephalic vein is where is the coracoid?
Sure.
I put a Homan there, and then I know where is the shoulder and what is safe and what is not safe. And then I'm going to take the coracoid and put it to the glenoid rim and disturb everything there. If I do it open or arthroscopic, it's the same. Now, what I'm going to have, I'm going to go open or arthroscopic to revise it. And the problem is that I'm going to an area that is disturbed, and of course, with experience, I can go and I can go very slowly, but I'm going to be very anxious the previous night. That's for sure.
And yes.
Also, if I do now, we can do Latarge with button. Pascal Boileau already has presented the technique with one pair of buttons, and Philippe
Valenci.
Also with two edges. It's the same type of thinking. Avoid the screws, because if you have a problem, screws are going to be very difficult there. And in my thinking, if we can solve the problem of most of the patients, now we have a recurrence rate of about 1%, 1 to 2% in my practice. We perform about 60 shoulder instability repairs a year. And we have very low recurrence rates and very very few problems that are very easy to solve in this way. That's why I think in this way.
No, I fully understand. It's very nice to know that we can think in a different way. I'm learning a lot here. I just want to mention, I'm not sure if Diego has left for a second, but I just want to just to add one thing which is very realistic to me is then when we indicate a Latarge with many previous episodes of dislocation, the soft tissue of the anterior capsule is not there anymore. Diego has mentioned that. So it becomes basically a bony block without any tissue to be repaired. This is what I've been seeing. Diego, I guess this is your experience with Latarge. Many episodes, the soft tissues, they are not there anymore. I would like to, I had the sensation you said that this is my impression in a way that we have nothing to repair in terms of soft tissue with many episodes when you do a Latarge. Do you feel the same? Because I had the sensation you have the same difficulties, Diego.
Yes, of course. I agree, Sergio. Here we have, unfortunately, we have a lot of rugby players, so we may have a different patient here. They do have a lot of trauma in the shoulder. And we, in Argentina, we have a big school of arthroscopic bunker repair. So we have most of these patients with a failed bunker, arthroscopic failed bunker at the beginning. So you have a really damaged capsule and also they have a previous surgery. So when we started to do the Latarge procedures in these patients, really difficult because you have prior surgeries, a very, very big bone defect, and they do a lot of trauma in the shoulder. So when we were there at the surgery, the capsule was nothing. So it has no sense at that moment to do a repair.
Yeah.
Yes. So we started with these patients and the results were pretty good. And we have some friends here in Argentina from different hospitals that they have the same experience. And we don't do usually a capsular repair in these patients. We are having good results. Of course, we cannot extrapolate this to the whole world, but we are not the only one and we are doing pretty good with this.
You know, it is not my experience. I have operated on patients for the fifth time and after 30 years of operating shoulders, I have always find something that I can repair. I was lucky perhaps, you know, in medicine, in medicine, there are two words that we should not use, always and never. But I have found capsules that were in very bad shape, some of them with even holes, multiple holes, but I was able to repair them. Some of them were very thin as well, but there is always something. It is my experience. I cannot say that I am the owner of the truth here. And I also
I agree with that. What I said is okay. I don't rely in that capsule. You will always find something, yes. Some tissue.
Okay,
but you know, I don't rely on
very poor tissue.
Okay, the good thing about the Rockwood's technique is that you have a double layer of capsule when you finish. You overlap the capsule. And you have sometimes more than a centimeter or centimeter and a half of capsule, even respecting the rotator, the rotation, the external rotation. So you have a double layer and the scar that is developed there, it's very strong. So that's important. And I also wanted to support Manos because he's not the only one. For instance, Ralph Hertel is a supporter of the bone block procedures as the first option, you know, not as a rescue. And he published some time ago a paper with 9 years follow-up with very good results. I think it's a very reliable technique what Manos has shown.
Yes, this is one of the papers that I saw that had a very long follow-up.
Yes.
And very important is that there are many modifications. When I did open repairs of the shoulder in my practice, I was very familiar with the puttiplat procedure in Greece.
I would mention that the puttiplat just yeah. now, sir. We are thinking the same, but you can go, Dr. Giannakis.
So the puttiplat procedure, we are taking part of the subscapularis to reinforce the capsule. And I think that every time you do an open repair, when you differentiate the subscapularis from the capsule, you create a cleavage where you can take part of the subscapularis and reinforce the capsule, part of the tendon of the subscapularis and reinforce the capsule in this way. And also, although that it's not only the quality of the capsule, it's the way of fixing the capsule. Mm-hmm. In open techniques, we use many sutures and many places in arthroscopic techniques, especially in the late 90s and early 2000, we were using three anchors, three sutures, two or three points of fixation. And sometimes we were using PDS. The classic article of Pascal Boileau and Frank Baz used panelock anchors with a PDS suture. And it's not peculiar to have very high recurrence rate. Now we use multiple fixation points. We use double loaded anchors. We use four anchors. We use we try in many ways to reinforce the way we suture the capsule back to the as we did with the open repair. And when we go this way, the recurrence rate of the Bankart repair, the arthroscopic Bankart repair, is not so high. First. Second is the type of the patient. We don't have rugby players in Greece. We have boxers, we have gymnasts, we have swimmers, we have volley.
Water basketball. Polo.
Water polo. Very, very hard athletics, but not rugby players. And this may make a difference also. But when we follow the patients and we see the recurrence rates. We don't see these dramatic recurrence rates of 30%, for example. For 30 to 40% is one every two patients. It's something that can pass unnoticed.
Yes.
Sergio, we need to go ahead. Sometimes things do not go as well as we want. And I think that we all need to learn lessons because many people in the 90s were telling us that they could cure everything with those two or three anchors. And it has been shown that was not like that. They were saying that, for instance, arthroscopic Bankart was the new gold standard. And it has been shown that was not like that. And it was necessary to include other steps, other procedures to have that the stability that we were expecting. I think that we must learn that lesson, that there are many things coming and they are shown as, you know, the great solution. And times shows that there's a good solution for some topics or for some type of patients and not for others. And I think that is nice that we have together the discussion of different topics. And of course, these techniques will fix some cases and not others, but we have another case and we must have in our toolbox different options for our patients. So Juan Pablo Simoni will show us that sometimes things are complicated. Juan Pablo is nowadays the president of the Argentinian Shoulder and Elbow Society. He is a doctor that was trained in his fellowship in the Mayo Clinic. And he has a lot of experience and I'm sure he will show you a very interesting case.
Thank you, Daniel. Can you hear me all right?
Yes, perfectly.
All right, so this is a case that I saw two or three weeks ago at the clinic. It's still not solved, but I think it's a nice case for discussion and for panel expert opinion. So this is a 38 year old right hand dominant male. His chief complaint, he comes to me because he has pain and feels instability of his right shoulder. He did have surgery. He underwent an arthroscopic Banker procedure at age 24. 2 years later, he tells me that his surgeon removed some anchors because he was feeling pain, and I'm putting partial anchor removal because he was not able to remove all the anchors. So when I see him at the clinic, he has a normal neurovascular exam. He has a well-healed anterior skin incision. So the first surgery was arthroscopic, second surgery for removal was open. And he has a functional range of motion and a functional cuff. So range of motion is, or strength is not really the problem. But he does have some apprehension. He tells me that every time he tries to engage new sports, he's not comfortable. He doesn't feel perfectly stable. He has a 1 out of 3 positive load and shift test anterior and a positive relocation test, but he didn't have any new recurrent dislocations, no more dislocations, just this subjective sense of instability. Pain at rest is 2 out of 10. And this is his problem. Pain with activity is 7 out of 10. So his main concern is he can't go back to training or to physical activity like he would want. These are his current x-rays. So these are the clinical exams that I have. So we can see that we have that inferior anchor and the partial anchor on the inferior edge of the glenoid. We can also see some wear of the glenohumeral joint, the heel sac lesions, a flattening of the humeral head. I'm going to show you the CT scans. We can see that the humeral head is nicely centered, but it has anterior impingement, anterior wear, anterior and inferior osteophytes. And as we go inferiorly, we can see that the anchors are still there, but they are not interfering now with the joint line. They are deep within the bone. And we can also see with a CT scan that the cuff looks pretty much well. It looks fine as it does clinically, right? And this is the 3D CT scan. Now we can see in the sagittal view of the glenoid, again, the inferior osteophyte of the glenoid surface and an estimated best fit circle deficit of 13% of his anterior glenoid. Now, just in summary, so we can advance with discussion, this is a 38-year-old patient with a painful arthritic instability. So if I would like to know your opinion, what do you do with these cases? I saw him 2 or 3 weeks ago. I just counseled him to start from zero. We're going to start with physical therapy and see how it takes on from there. But I'm going to see this patient again probably in 2 or 3 weeks. And I would like to know what your opinion is if this patient doesn't do well with physical therapy. If you will go ahead with any other surgical procedure, what would you do if this patient still complains about pain and sensation of instability?
Juan Pablo, to begin, it was not necessary to ask the patient to wear dressing. He was dressed with the national soccer team t-shirt just to bother Sergio. You know that.
No, that's okay.
Complications that's okay. With Brazil about soccer. But yes. besides that, I completely agree that the first step with these patients is rehab. There is no rush to go ahead to a second surgery. We all know that if we repeat surgeries, then the more the number of surgeries, the less the chance to have a solution. So or it is more difficult. So I would like to know the opinion of all the panelists about that, about rehab, if they trust that there is an option for that. What about the manos?
Okay, now, this is not a problem, in my opinion, and as I can see, this is not a problem of instability. It's a problem of arthritis in the young, active patient. And this is very different and very difficult to solve. And I think that if you do an operation for instability in this patient, the things that we are going to do is that we are going to make him more stiff and more symptomatic. And this is a problem. What we do in patients that are young, active, and have arthritic changes, symptomatic arthritic changes, many times these changes are not symptomatic. I have seen a lot of patients that come with this CT and MRIs, and they are not symptomatic. And I say, oof, happily, they are not symptomatic, because just continue as you are doing well. What happened now, when we have patients that are symptomatic, for me, the first and most important question is, how long are the symptoms? Because the symptoms are coming in crisis. And what produces the symptoms? It's very important, because if we can find that a small modification in activity can change the, lower the symptoms, then again, we solve the problem, at least for a while.
For a while.
Yes. And so I would start the same, start with physio. I would try to explain to the patient that the problem is not a problem of instability, but a problem of that is going to be with him for many years, for all his life probably. And that we can, what, the only thing that we can do is to postpone a total shoulder replacement. And we will try to postpone it for as long as possible, because he is very young. And we want him to have a good quality of life. And we'll try to give him a good quality of life, conservative measures with minor operations. And if we don't have a good quality of life, we are going to do a total joint shoulder replacement, and then hope for this to last for as long as possible.
Yes, for a lot of time.
Yeah. And this is how it goes when I have to deal with, treat this patient. And if this patient comes from another doctor, it's very easy to say that. But if it comes from my patient, it's very difficult. Yeah.
You see, Dr. Manos, I fully agree, but I have to mention something very important. There is no proper treatment without a proper diagnosis. This is a principle in every field of medicine. In a way that in this case of Dr. Juan Pablo, we have to first establish the proper diagnosis, which is not exactly easy. I fully agree that the arthritic component is more important than the instability component. And in a way, in the same way that we say that the patient with knee arthritis, he has pain when he walks and not exactly when he's seated. In the same way, this patient is becoming more symptomatic when he's using the shoulder. So I fully agree that I would say post-traumatic, post-operative the neurohumeral arthritis is the problem here, which is a very difficult situation in the young patient. One thing that I would suggest in spite of physio would be intra-articular injections of hyaluronic acid, Synvisc, all of or these other ones. This is not gonna cure anything, but this is gonna be, I would say, clinically beneficial for a while. And maybe we can, I would say, go with this for some years, as Dr. Manos said, but I have seen patients with intra-articular injections every 4 months, every 6 months, with, I would say, a lot of enhancement in pain. Another point is that the psychological aspects of this patient must be very well addressed. It means a very realistic conversation with him to say, excuse me, Houston, we have a problem, a real situation. And in my opinion, a TSA, a total shoulder arthroplasty, in this point is not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. So we have to postpone it. This is a very good case to send to our best enemies, as somehow Dr. Manos has said. But Dr. Juan, I think that intra-articular injections, and even, sir, that would be somehow, I would say, after you do that, a therapeutical test, in a way that at least for 2 months, he's going to be better. And this therapeutical test will give you the clinical information that the diagnosis is really arthritis and not exactly instability. But
Sergio, sorry. Don't you think that there is also some component of shoulder instability? Because the patient is complaining has a positive apprehension test. I don't know, Juan Pablo, you have seen the patient, you have examined the patient. What would you say? Because,
that is what is tricky about this patient particularly, because he doesn't have the typical stiffness and pain that goes with arthropathy, but he has sense of instability. So he tells me that he is not able to engage sports activity because he feels his shoulder might dislocate again. That's his subjective feeling. So it's very difficult for me to see how much of this is persistent instability and how much is the proper arthritis.
Juan Pablo, and do you think that's the main complaint? That's the main reason why the patient comes to you? Do you feel that if you can, repair that or fix that, the instability feeling that perhaps he will not recover complete range of motion, he will keep on having some pain, but perhaps will feel better in everyday activities?
I hope that gets better with exercises and tonification of his shoulder, so he feels that he's more stable. But I don't think he's a good candidate for any instability procedure at this stage. That's the problem.
What do you think?
Manos. Go ahead.
Okay. The painful shoulder in these patients, in the young arthritic patients, has good days and bad days. And if you speak with the patient and put him to confront the reality of his shoulder and do the rehabilitation program concerning this situation, sometimes the result is much better than that you wait for. And I think that hyaluronic injection or other biological therapies like PRPs and other things can help to the pain reduction. But I think that the patient should know his problem. And if a patient has a heart infraction, cannot run to the stairs. And if has an arthritic shoulder, cannot do some things. With the proper rehabilitation, he can have a normal life to play with his kids, to do some sporting exercise, but he cannot be a high-class athlete.
Yes.
However, we can discuss for hours about this situation, but we should give the opportunity to Angelos Trelopoulos to present his case. Angelos Trelopoulos is an ex-fellow of our department, and now is consultant for our department, and we wait for your presentation.
Hey, thank you very much. My presentation is a little bit different from the last speaker because we give a solution to our patient, but you can say what you will do about him. So as Manos told, I am a consultant at the Third Orthopedic Department at the Gia Hospital here in Greece. Behind me, you can see our hospital. So first of all, I want to thank the organization committee for this kind invitation. And I will present this case that was treated in our department for current shoulder instability. Our patient was a 21 years old male, a handball player. He had a traumatic dislocation in his non-dominant hand. And when he was 15 years old, he was treated arthroscopically with a soft tissue procedure for another surgical team. And 1 year after the initial surgery, he had a rib dislocation, and since then, 2 dislocations and 4 subluxations. Finally, he had a new surgery in our department on April 2019. As you can see here, the patient has general ligamentous laxity. Here you can see his preoperative range of motion and his functional scores. He had a large glenoid bone loss combined with a heel sacs lesion. And the shape of his glenoid was an inverted pier. He underwent a bone block procedure combined with ASA and RBSAR. And here you can see his postoperative 3D CT. 6 months post-op, he had a full range of motion, no pain, and his functional score were improved. He returned to his previous athletic activity 6 months post-op. So, in shoulder joint mobility presents stability. But what did we learn the last 20 years of treating shoulder instability? First of all, as Dr. Donoyanaki said, the Bagger lesion is the essential lesion, but not the only one. And shoulder stability is a multifactorial entity. On 2004, our clinic conducted a study in which a comparison of the spectrum of intra-articular region in acute and chronic anterior shoulder stability took place. This study demonstrated that major lesions occur from the first dislocation and are becoming worse as the episodes are being repeated. Surgeon decision depends on factors that are individualized for every patient. In our case, the glenoid bone defects, the anterior soft tissue wall deficiency, and the shoulder hyperlaxity, as well as the type of athletic activity were taken into account. On 2000, Burhan and Debir highlighted the role of bone defects in failure of Bangard procedure. The Denhividen procedure, our choice, is a procedure which treats the primary and the revision cases of instability. And the Tora Taverna upgrade the technique and transform it to an arthroscopic one. To our patient, the stabilization of the graft was made by special buttons and was combined by RBSAR and TASA, which is this way because it's a technical easier with less possible complication and is easy revision in case of recurrence. Finally, in a very recent study from our clinic, we saw the very good results from this method. And we know from this awarded study, there is no difference in clinical and radiological outcomes when compared Latarge and bone block procedure. In conclusion, the surgeon must have in mind that every patient is individualized and we must treat him as a different entity. So, I want to invite you to our courses. And I want to highlight the Greek and Argentinian ties. And this is Bartolome Mirte Martinez, who was one of the presidents of Argentina, and he had the Greek roots. And also these two war heroes from the Argentinian independence, Admiral Yorgos John Colmagnatis and Miguel Samuel Spiro. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Angelos. Yes, that's true. We have a president that was, that he had a Greek ancestors, and his surname was shortened when he came to Argentina. I do not advise you to have an Argentinian president, please.
That's well, That's really
okay.
For us, we do have a Greek one, so.
Okay, good. A very nice case, very well presented. I really like that case, and that's another message that we would like to give to our audience, that every patient must be individualized. And as Sergio said, we need to begin with a very clear diagnosis to decide the treatment.
Daniel, in this case, we should highlight that we add Remplissaz and ASA, both Remplissaz and ASA, and the external rotation was 90 degrees. So this is an answer to your previous comment.
Can I add something? Sorry.
Yes, go ahead.
Can I add something?
Yes, okay. Of course.
As you can see, in this patient who had the anterior soft tissue wall insufficiency, but we combine ASA to put the bone block, as you can combine it with DAS, that dynamic anterior stabilization. This operation, if you read the articles, they try to reproduce the slink effect of Latarze procedure. Mm-hmm. Because there is a point that around the world, Latarze or other bone procedures, in some cases, they are over-treat.
I agree.
These operations try to make the slink effect without the complications and the one shot of procedure of Latarze.
Good. Well, friends, I think it was a very nice session. I think we should repeat this with a different topic. The discussion was short because we are on time, but I think that we could have keep on discussing these cases. And I offer you, Manos, Angelos, to, if we have the chance, I am sure that we will have the support of OrthoTV to organize these kind of meetings more regularly. He's the boss. Here is the boss. Let's listen to him. Do you agree, Ashok?
I absolutely agree. It was a fantastic meeting. And looking at the experiences from different countries gives a very good insight into how surgeons are thinking locally and applying the principles globally. So it's very important for us to know thought processes from various countries. So surely in future, we'll try to organize more and more such meetings.
Good. And Manos, you have enlightened my weekend, because if you move to summer, the meeting, my wife will be very happy.
You will be the first to know, okay? If it happens, you will be the first that you will know.
Okay, we will, but besides,
next time.
Yes, we must go to many. She wants to go to Santorini. He needs to go before dying to Santorini, you know. But the point is that besides that, the situation is not easy anywhere, everywhere. Sorry. So to gain some months, it is a wise decision, I feel. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you to all our audience. We have a big audience. Dr. Ashok will tell us the final numbers in a couple of days. Thank you very much to all the Indian doctors that always support us, that they know very well Sergio. And we want to say hi to our friends in Greece and in Argentina and all over Latin America. Sergio, do you want to close? Manos, do you want to say something, please?
I just want to say one thing. I'm very happy, but just one final message to the audience. I learned a lot today, but Dr. Angelo, I'm talking to the young surgeons now. Just one phrase. He said something extremely important, that the Bankart lesion is the essential lesion, but not the not the only issue to be addressed. So these augmentation procedures, they are becoming more popular because they work. And we have to respect the learning curves, of course. But once you know how to do this, we are enhancing our tools, as Dr. Daniel has mentioned. So we learned more tools today, at least I learned a lot. So our inventory is becoming wiser, and this is light in the end of the tunnel. And as we say in Brazil, is light in the end of the tunnel, and it's not a train coming against you, it's light. So this is, I just wanna say thank you. And once again, as Dr. Daniel has said, thanks Orto TV for supporting us. And we are absolutely sure that Dr. Ashok and Dr. Neeraj will be with us in subsequent events to give us all of the support for all of these things to happen. And thanks, Dr. Manos. Dr. Manos on my right and Dr. Manos on my left. If you want to say something, Dr. Manos, left and right, please, the microphone is yours.
Thank you for hosting. Thank you for the feeling, and I enjoyed a lot this webinar.
And next time, not in virtual, but in real, in Greece, with Argentinian wire and a lot of oil. Thank you for the olive oil.
Thank you very much, Diego, bye. Juan Pablo, thank you. We will keep on doing things.
Have a nice weekend.
Thank you, Ashok. You too. Bye-bye.
Thank you.